It's on the internet.
We will get to it. Greetings from Somerville, everybody. I am your host, Michael Somerville, and my guest today is...
Kristin Key. Hi, everybody.
Oh, my goodness.
Hello.
From the road, we are...
I am on the road.
Live in Las Vegas,
we
speak. Kristin is performing here, her final evening.
This is it. Yeah, my bags are packed.
Ready to go.
Ready to go, yeah.
And Somerville is moving into town for the week.
We're missing each other by one day.
Just by a day, but I came early just to say
I'm
hello.
So glad.
That's not true. I had nowhere else to go, so I just came
that
early.
That makes more sense. I was so upset that we're going to miss each other because usually we work together and we text each other pictures from the bath.
That is.
But they're the cleanest pictures. They're the most wholesome pictures. Like I'll send a picture of just like my white foot or just like my face amongst bubbles. And I'll just get back a picture of like two extremely red knees in a bathtub or just a picture of a pizza box next to a bathtub because we get these really nice sweets, and I think we both abuse the sweet.
Let's back up for our listeners for a second. In this day and age of sending, you know, naked selfies and all the things that these kids are doing.
You're the only person I send nudes to.
Kristin and I, we have these wonderful jacuzzi tubs where they put us up for this job at the MGM in Vegas. It's lovely. And I am a huge hot tub / bath person.
Yeah.
Kristin, we discovered at some point in our travels and conversations, feels the same.
It's a perk of the job. I don't spend a lot of the hotel rooms I'm typically in do not have a deluxe luxury jacuzzi in my bath. Usually it's a bathtub that you wouldn't go into without getting an infection.
Funny enough, this week my agent tried to sweeten a gig by telling me, hey, they put the comics up in a place that has a bathtub. I'm like, you couldn't pay me. A place where comics have been for the last 20 years and I'm going to go,
right. They
probably pee in it.
Right.
So,
not a shared.
No.
The perk of the jacuzzi in the suite, an en-suite jacuzzi, I think is what it's called.
I don't know. You're dropping terms.
It's an en-suite jacuzzi. Is that there's a housekeeper that comes, not, well, we've discussed this too, privately. Not for us. We don't let them in.
No.
Privately, we've discussed that both of us have had what's called a wellness check.
Yeah.
And it's embarrassing. It's really, because I had it today. A lady knocked on my door and said, are you okay? In 4 days, if you haven't turned off your do not disturb sign,
right.
Not a housekeeper, it's a lady with a clipboard.
Yes.
Like a uniformed lady, and she came like she's going to check off like,
are you alive?
She's alive, she's wearing pants. Like I was like, yeah, I'm fine. Like I'm up, I've had breakfast. Like,
it's like your mom checking on you.
Yeah, I'm good. Like I got up early, like I haven't left, you know, or whatever.
But I am a functioning adult.
And then I told her, I was like, I even talked to my housekeeper yesterday.
Wait, did your housekeeper come yesterday?
Yeah, and she didn't clean the room. I didn't let her in. It's like I traded her some towels for some trash.
Oh, okay, yes.
And I gave her $10, and I thought the $10 might get me out of that check.
The wellness check,
yeah,
yes.
I want my $10 back.
Oh, exactly. Oh, I had the very same thing, because I was do not disturb for a couple days, and then finally
like
one
seven.
Night, maybe six.
I know you.
How long's the gig? But one night I did call because I was out of everything. So when I was heading to the show, I called and said, hey, can I get someone to come tonight and fix it up? So it wasn't part of the regular scheduled visit, but it was a visit.
Sure
enough, next day I get the knock. I'm like, what the? And lady with the clipboard. And I said, it's Las Vegas. Staying in the room is the only chance I have of being well. I mean,
have
you been out there?
I'm taking care of myself.
Trying not to do that. Exactly.
Yeah.
I love it. Well, we sit in the tub. We had an epic week working together where you went all out on the tub. You went out and got bubbles
I got an inner tube.
That's right.
I actually got the rainbow inner tube, which did not quite fit in the tub, but I was trying to send better nudes.
A little more
and
enticing.
They hit a lot more, too. I could take more shots. My wife was like, I was like, is it okay that I send nudie pics to Summer? But she goes, yeah. Send as many as you want. I don't care. She's met Michael, and she's like, they're like brother and sister.
Not threatened.
No. I think she likes him better. She likes me. She's like, you send him whatever you want.
Because I'll get red knees back.
he can have you.
Now, one night, you bequeathed the ducky to me, and rather than take him to the pool, I took him gambling. I don't know if you remember this.
I bought a yellow rubber ducky, and I gave you the duck for the night. I said, go, take him for a bath. I got pictures of that duck having debauchery.
A night out in Vegas.
Oh, my God. The duck come back different.
He was on the roulette table.
He squeaked with a rasp. He didn't go, he went, I think that duck saw that night.
Never the same.
That's right.
He wasn't even quite yellow anymore.
His eyes were a little gray. He'd been around.
Oh, my goodness. So what do you do on the road then? Because we've worked both on the road for years and years. And
yeah.
We've stayed in some good places, some bad places. What's your norm? What's your go-to? Do you structure your day?
Changed a lot. I got sober 2 years ago.
Okay.
So it changed a lot. Used to, it would be like, I go to the show.
Right.
I drink my face off.
Okay.
I go to a few bars. I black out. I go to several more bars. And then the next day, I forage for food at like 2 or 3.
Survival.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And now it's like, I wake up about 9. You know, I find breakfast. And I look around towns to see, oh, look what this town has.
I love it.
Like Chattanooga has a walking bridge. I've played there for like 10 years. I'd
never
been past the comedy club. I was like, oh, they have a comedy club and it hurts. And now I'm like, oh, what a delightful little city. They have charming places. but yeah, I've been doing the road since I was 20.
Have you really?
Yeah. So I started really young, and I've been
wow.
to some places that were difficult for me as a heavy drinker.
Yeah.
Like Louisville used to really be rough. There's the Bardstown Road had a comedy club there, and there were times where I would I'd go to there was a place called the Highland Tap Room right across the street from the comedy club.
All
right. So I'd finish my 3 shows on a Saturday.
Good Lord.
And I mean, I was a day drinker, so
okay.
I'd have a few drinks in the afternoon.
Okay.
Go do 3 shows, and then go over to the Highland Tap Room, and then I remember at one point some of the staff found me crawling down the sidewalk. And what I thought was funny about this is they found me, picked me up. But before that, somebody walked past me and just went, oh, she's cute. I was like, in Louisville, Kentucky, no one thinks it's odd that a woman is just like, I couldn't quite get up on my, you know, it's like a little baby giraffe. Can't quite get up yet.
Right.
I was
right.
like, I'll get it. I just couldn't quite get up. Louisville was rough.
Are they checking you out from the ground, though?
Oh, yeah, she's cute. If she ever stands up, yeah, she's gonna be a keeper. I like her.
I love it.
My 21st birthday, I spent in what I remember the city name being was Gun Barrel City, Texas.
Gun Barrel City, Texas.
That's what I remember the name of the city being. And
was it the name? Or?
I'm not sure. I just turned, it was on my 21st birthday, and this man named Gary Hood, which I believe is dead now.
Okay.
Was, he booked a one-nighter in a place called the Bait Bucket.
Bait Bucket.
The Bait Bucket.
Bait Bucket.
Yeah, yeah.
Love
like
this.
Fish and tackle bait.
In Gun Barrel.
Yeah, and it was my very first time to headline.
Oh.
And oh, I was so excited. So I dressed up. You know, because I'm thinking I'm a headliner.
This is it.
Yeah. I made it.
Dressing up meaning
yeah.
like your finest clothing.
Like I wore, yeah, it's the 90s. So I wore like clunky black shoes.
Okay.
Like my nicest pair
like
of lucky jeans.
Going out.
A jacket.
Got you. Okay.
Like I tried to look as straight as possible.
Right.
You know?
For Gun Barrel, Texas.
Right. Because at the time I was super in the closet. And so Gary Hood, I had to meet him at his apartment. He would drive us both from
right.
Dallas to there.
Right.
And we get to his apartment. At first he was like, oh, it's your 21st birthday. You want to do coke? I was like, no, I don't think I should. And so I didn't. And that kind of put a bad taste in my mouth for that headlining gig.
I would think.
Mm-hmm.
And
we got to the gig, and I went up dead last. There were like 6 comics, and they were all doing time, and the club didn't – it wasn't a club. It was a bar,
uh-huh.
the Bait Bucket. And they all did not want comedy to be happening. And anyway, I went up last, and they were all real rowdy, and I was real mad about it. And so I got in a verbal fight with a lady that had bad teeth, and I insulted her teeth. And then she wanted to fight me, and I had to be escorted out. And it was one of the worst gigs ever.
Oh,
and that was my 21st birthday.
That was your birthday. Now, where's that coke?
I know. And I think I got $75.
Oh, man. Oh,
I'm a headliner
man.
Now.
This is it.
I'm going to be rich.
Everything I dreamed about.
I know.
Well, I remember when I started, that's all I wanted. I wanted to headline clubs.
Yeah.
You know, you start out and you're opening and then you get the feature. And I thought, if I would be happy if I could just become a headliner
yeah.
and travel the country telling jokes. And I guess, as with everything, once you get it, you say, okay, maybe not quite.
Well, maybe not headlining here.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
I remember Bill Burr once, I heard him say, because he had gotten to that point, and he said, I want to get to the point where I'm just doing one night at the club, or just the weekend, the Friday to Saturday. I come in, I'm big enough to just do the Friday, Saturday at the club.
Right.
And of course, now he's doing theaters and everything, but I think
I wonder if he has something else now. He's like, oh, I just want to be able to just go in and do 15.
I would think, exactly.
I just want to be able to just go in and
FaceTime my set from my hotel room. Just put me on the screen.
Oh, just from the back. Hi, everybody. I'm Kristin. It's me in a bathtub with a duck.
With the duck.
Here's my favorite joke. Thank you.
But I bet so, right? You bet. I mean, some guys, you know, just love the road. They want to do it. But I think in general, yeah, we all kind of want. I mean, for me, it was like a talk show or a sitcom. I mean, something to get off the road and be home
yeah.
in my bed making good money. But just, you know, somehow you're not traveling.
It's the travel I don't like. I love the shows. And I like the challenge of like. Because like we were just talking about cruise ships and
right.
the different shows. Like I'm about to go on a Holland America cruise
uh-huh.
with considerably older people than the Vegas crowd I'm about to play tonight. So my show is Apples and Oranges.
And it really, is it that
yeah,
drastically different too?
I wrote a completely different show.
Wow.
I mean,
that's impressive.
There's maybe, I would say, a 30% overlap.
Okay.
But a 70% different show
okay.
for a cruise ship.
Wow.
You know, just to make it more family friendly.
Yeah.
You know?
You might be like, I'm an accountant. And
yeah, I'm a completely different person. I come out in a collared gown. Because that's how it's my accountant firm.
My name is Jim.
No, I talk about like, I'll talk about the buffet more. Like,
okay,
I'll
sure.
relate to our experiences on the ship.
Sure.
I'll talk about more of like, my travels. And I'll talk about that in Vegas.
Right.
You know, in Vegas,
right.
I talk about different stuff. So it's like, I just pull from different patches of my comedy what's more palatable to the audience in front of. I like the challenge, but I don't like, I actually enjoy my wife.
Right.
And so it's like, I know comics that are like, oh, I love the road. And
right,
I'm like,
right.
Oh, you hate your wife.
Right, right. You don't want to be home.
Right,
right.
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 I like being off leash a little
exactly.
bit.
Exactly.
I get it. Yeah.
Exactly. Like that. No, and I know your wife, and she's awesome.
Ah, she's wonderful.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
And people are like, why don't you take her with you? I'm like, oh, because what I like about her is that she also has a life.
But she's got her stuff,
yeah.
too. Exactly. No, which is important,
yeah.
I think. Yeah.
I guess there's a balance somewhere.
Well, yeah, and
yeah.
I think, you know, exactly. It's nice to have the option. I mean,
yeah,
to be able
yeah.
to, like, go and well, like Brad Garrett, who we're working for here at this club. I mean, but, you know, he's able to bring his fiance with him if he wants. She also has her thing.
Right,
so
right.
That's a nice luxury to have. If you
yeah.
want to come to the gig, come to the gig. Yeah, I'm in the same situation. I can't bring you because I can't afford to.
You know? That's a big thing, too. So, like, why don't you bring her everywhere? I was like, do you want to pay for her plane ticket?
Exactly,
like,
yeah.
You want to fly her out?
Exactly. Now, I was laughing about the cruise ship stuff because I just did a cruise and you know, we obviously have worked years on our craft, and writing jokes is not an easy thing. And some of the ones that I'm most proud of, and I'm sure you're most proud of, took time. And it's just like, they're bad. And then inevitably on a cruise ship, like, one of the strange things about it to me was that you get to see the audience for a week. So
yeah.
normally we do a show, they leave, and it's over. We never talk to those people again unless they find you on social media. On a ship, they're right there, and they're looking at you at dinner and the whole thing.
Yeah.
And one of the interesting things to me was they call back jokes, and you find out what jokes they liked and what did. And
yeah.
sometimes to me that was helpful because there was a joke I wasn't sure about, and I would hear a few people go, "I really like that." Well, you're like, oh, that gave me confidence. But more often than not, it's like the joke about the buffet or the ship toilet or the whatever. And you just die a little inside. You're like, that was the funniest joke ever about the, yeah. And you're like, oh, all those. Because
it's what we're all living together. It's our shared experience.
Exactly.
Yeah. It's like, I wrote that. I wrote that specific way. But I mean, I wrote it specifically because I was in a jam.
Right, right, right.
Because I was on my first cruise ship. And I was like, my act isn't going to cut it. This ain't going to cut it. They're not going to like all this mainland stuff. I'm going to have to dig up some cruise stuff. And so I just lived on the ship for a few days panicking. And I was like, what? And I got fascinated by the buffet life. And I wrote a couple songs about it. And I turned them into a 5-minute bit and was like, genius.
We got it there.
Genius. I have a song about a hot dog. And it's great. Thank God. Jesus was with me at the buffet. Thanks, Jeebus.
But now, interestingly, out of necessity, like we said, when you start your hosting and you want a feature, but you need the time, then you headline and all of a sudden you're, I need the time.
Yeah.
And again, out of necessity, you came up with bits. And I think that is when comics can get lazy, when once you have it. You know,
right.
I remember a comedian
right.
once telling me on the road, if you get an evergreen 40 minutes, timeless, you'll never work again for the rest of your life. I was like, that sounds like the most horrible thing.
That's awful.
Isn't that terrible? Yeah. That sounds so depressing.
I started out at the Amarillo Comedy Club when I was 19, and I would watch comics come through town, and some of them had the same act for like 8 years.
Forever.
When I worked there. And I don't know, I put out a new album every 3 years, and so that kind of keeps me.
Do you really?
I do.
As a set thing.
Yeah.
Okay, every 3 years. Okay.
Well, I did it for the first, like, I haven't won 3 years later, I did another one, and then I was like, well, now I gotta do it again. And so it keeps me in the habit of burning material every about 3 years or so.
Absolutely.
And it's really helpful to, like, at least stay writing.
Absolutely.
And churning out, and I hate the process a little bit.
Yes.
But only when it's we're about a year and a half in, and I'm like, but I love that when it's like, this is a golden 45. Everything's working perfectly, and I love it. It's so beautiful. And you're like, well, now it's time to ditch it.
Yeah.
Oh, my God, but they're all polished. They're all polished gems right now. It's like,
perfect.
Doesn't matter. Now you got to start from scratch with crap.
Oh.
You got to bring out some turds now. They're gross. And you got to throw them right in the middle where people watching your act are like, this is so good. What was that?
What is wrong with that?
That was really good.
That
was a hiccup in that show. And you're like, come back in 2 months, and that'll be better.
It'll be better.
I promise it'll be better. Like,
good for you, though. You have to have the discipline to just force it. You got to get it in.
You know.
Yeah.
What are you going to do? I mean.
If you do the same 45 for the next 20 years. I mean, that's exactly.
Some people love them. I mean, they're good jokes.
Yeah.
You're not going to. I mean, they get better and better and better. You know?
And then once you do the album, that's it for you? You say, okay, those are out there and done?
About a year and a half later, because then I start thinking about the new one.
Okay.
So it's like, I don't burn them immediately because I love them.
Right.
Because right after the album comes out, then they really get good.
Right. Don't you find that?
Yeah. Usually right after I record the album, I was like, oh, man, I could have tagged that better. And then I listen to it like a month later. I'm like, oh, that sucks.
Yep.
That album sucks. And then it's like all that material is like, this is the album I wanted. I can't. You know?
Right.
But that's how comics are. We're always so
never
hypercritical.
Be satisfied. I was watching Seinfeld in an interview talking about how he has trouble watching his own sitcom because he's like, I just see what's wrong with it.
It'll never be good enough for us.
Yeah. It's like, really? Yeah.
But I think accepting that's our art form, you know, that it's like, you know, we could edit it to death.
Right.
But understand that the audience is happy.
Right, exactly.
You know, and it's not about us.
That's a great
point.
You
know, we put our ego aside. You know, it's never about us. It's like 50-50. It's part us, part them.
Yeah.
You know, just let them be happy and move on.
Right, right.
You know,
that's a great point. Like, what is the definition of the biggest laugh ever? I mean, how much more can you get out of them as opposed to it's time for the next joke?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Move on. Let it go.
Yeah.
Start working on the next one. Polish that turd.
But that's a great, I mean, and that then it is good to have that finish line of a CD or whatever it is because, like, now it's done. It's over. That's it. A lot of guys will do if I did, you know, the big names are doing a special. Okay, well, now it's on TV. Now you've seen it. And it's over.
Yeah.
And yeah. Among the things you do to pass the time, crochet.
I love to crochet. do you know what's funny? It's that, like, because other people that crochet will talk to me, and I'm like, I never relate to them the way they want to be related to. So I'm like, I don't think I crochet like you do. Like, because I started really getting to crocheting when I quit drinking to give my hands something to do because they were shaking a lot. So they'll be like, oh, you crochet? And I'm like, oh, yeah. And they're like, do you scrapbook too? I'm like, nah, do you ever try Coke? Like, no, okay, good talk.
We don't have anything else in common.
We're not doing this right. Oh, man.
So was it a time filler?
It was. It gave my brain something to do because my brain was like, it wouldn't shut up. And so it's like, it really shuts your brain down. You're just like, oh, just kind of counting loops and like reading a pattern, watching TV.
Right.
But I had to do things that other crocheters do, like go to Joann's. And it's like, it's not a place I thought of.
Store.
It's a craft store where like there's fabric and yarn. I like the yarn, but there's a smell to a Joann's that's like, It's like Christmas in a hoarder's garage. It's like pleasant, but not. It's like all the holidays are having a smell fight at once. It's like
It sounds very specific.
It is. It's like someone's using the employee break room microwave to cook essential oils. So it's like it's a good hobby to have at home, but every time you have to go out and find new yarn, it's like, oh, I don't want to talk to these people, and I don't want to smell these smells, but I want more yarn.
But you want my yarn.
Now it's my addiction. It's like I need jonesing for it.
You gotta start learning about scrapbooking.
All my pictures would be like passed out people at bars. With stickers on them. I'm like, yuck.
That's me in Louisville. They said I was really cute. But I'm glad you're still going, because I'm assuming you can order online these days. I'm sure it's easy to find yarn online.
Yeah.
And then you really become that homebody. So you're at least still going to Joann's.
I'm still going to Joann's.
Okay.
And mainly because also my wife likes to take pictures of me in Joann's and make fun of me online. It's like, now it's her Instagram story. It's her being annoyed by me and Joann's. Yeah, so I didn't know she was doing it the first few times, and then I would get out and be like, what's going on your Instagram story? She was like, oh, yeah, I get bored in there, so I just Instagram you looking at the same yarn. I'm like, well, it takes a minute, you know.
I'm sure it's a process. Does she have any appreciation? Does she care at all about crochet?
She likes, like, I make little stuffed animals for kids, and they're adorable. So cute.
Yeah.
And so, and then everybody wants something, but she wants me to make her stuff. And I'm like, I don't like it when people ask me to make them stuff, I turn into, like, a scene from Pretty Woman. I'm like, I say who, I say when, I say who, you know. Or like that scene when she's shopping and people are like,
kiss you on the lips. Where'd that come from?
They'll be like, oh, say, oh yeah, I crochet. They're like, oh, you should make me some. I'm like, no, it didn't work. They're like, no, I'll pay you. I'm like, oh, you couldn't afford it. It's really expensive. I think you should leave. Like, tomorrow.
And then right to the bathtub.
I'm singing Prince in there, crocheting.
Oh my goodness. My cheeks are for me. So a little crochet, a little scene of the town, on the road. Okay.
Yeah. Oh, and I bring a mini Super Nintendo with me wherever I go now.
Do you really?
Yeah. I upped my game. I party now.
That's
me partying.
That's
so now I can stay up past midnight.
Playing your video game.
Yeah.
There is a comic I worked with once who literally took a road gigs just because he's married with kids, and he took it
so
just so he could play
game.
His video games.
Yeah.
Yeah, he literally would go and just bring his thing and just play video games all day and all night. I've never gotten into them. As a kid, I played, and then as an adult, I said I don't need a vice, because I could see like my friends getting so hooked on stuff. What
That's
is your
fun.
Game? What's your
well on Xbox? I was playing Battlefront, but Xbox is too big to travel with. I mean, I usually do it in Vegas because I just move in here. Like that's the last of my bags. I had three more.
And you drive?
Yeah,
perfect.
So I move into my.
Oh, driving
suite.
To
yeah.
a gig is like just bring your whole
I just
house
move
with
in.
You.
I
yeah.
live here for the week, but. But for my birthday this year, I got this mini Super Nintendo.
Oh.
So my wife got me into Zelda, and I'd never really played Zelda.
Okay.
And so she came out this week, and I was like, oh, we can start playing it together.
Okay.
You know, see if I like it. Because if I get hooked on it, then I'll play it on the cruise.
See if you like it. Okay.
Yeah, because she loves it. She's
okay.
playing like two different Zelda games right now, and she has this little mini clamshell, what is it? It's a... Game Boy Advanced, and it opens. So I tell her to quit filling with her clam, because it's a little clamshell Game Boy. You
okay.
know? Anyway, she doesn't like that either. And,
I just don't want to have to edit this.
Okay. So it's a game. It's a Game Boy, and it opens and closes like a clamshell. So it's not dirty.
Let's leave it at that.
So anyway, so I got the little. The Super Nintendo Mini, and I've been playing the Zelda, and I got super hooked on it.
Right.
And so now I feel like a big-time nerd. I'll come down to the comedy club every night, and Zach's like, are you playing Zelda? And I'm like, yeah. So Link got flippers, and now I can swim, and I got like 50 arrows, so I think I'm going to be okay. All right. Just seeing if you went out gambling last night. I was like, no, I don't gamble. I'll lose all my rupees. Yeah.
Perfect.
Big time party.
Were you into, what was the crazy thing, Pokemon? When everyone was
I
shooting?
Never did the Pokemon
okay.
Go. I didn't do
are
that.
They losers, those people in quarantine?
I don't know. It's like watching them walk around LA.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
They look like losers. Just
okay.
people on their phones bumping into each other. And they said, I heard people say it's how they meet people, but all I saw was like people bumping into going, sorry. keep walking, looking for Pokemon.
They're not
things.
Meeting anybody.
No, they're just apologizing to real people.
Oh my goodness. Well, tell the people where they can look for you, where they can find you, when there's new albums coming out, if they want to watch some of your comedy.
I got a website, it's kristinkey.com, and it's Kristen with two I's. and a key at the end. And then I'm on YouTube. It's youtube.com/Kristin Key Comedy. And you can follow me and everything on Facebook and Twitter and Instagram. But you can find all that on KristinKey.com. I got a dry bar special coming up that's going to be taped next month.
Congratulations.
Thank you. And then I'm recording my fifth stand-up album in October at the Tacoma Comedy Club. I'm real excited about that.
Fabulous.
Yeah, my schedule's online, so find me somewhere. We can talk crochet. If you used to drink and crochet, then we're going to have a lot in common.
We have a lot, for the love of mercy,
yeah,
please.
If you knit and quilt, don't talk to me.
And don't bring up scrapbooking.
No, God.
Well, I cannot thank you enough for taking the time. I know you got a show to get to.
I adore
to.
You, Michael. Anytime.
My goodness, please. This is so lovely, and I can't wait to watch you be funny as ever, which I always is my favorite thing. Ladies and gentlemen, greetings from Somerville. Check out Kristin's great stuff. You can like, rate, and review us on iTunes, and we will see you soon. Thanks for tuning in.